Almost everybody today has heard of the New Age movement, Shirley MacLaine, and channeling. In this subject, Pastor Cox will take a look at the secret that runs through all the organizations of the New Age movement, and will answer questions that you may have on the subject.
Thank you very much. If you're familiar with such terms as Age of Aquarius, Buddhism, Hinduism, Jonathan Livingston Seagull, Feinhorn, then you are familiar with the New Age terms. If you're familiar with these people that have given leadership to it, such as Shirley MacLaine, then you have read some about the New Age movement that has grown in the last 10 years. Many people have turned to it. There is a great difference between the thinking process of the New Age movement and the thinking process of Christianity, because much of the New Age movement centers its thinking in Eastern religions. And you'll find that Eastern religions, their thought process is inwardly. They talk about thinking inwardly, concentrating upon themselves. Wherein Christianity does not do that. Christianity thinks outwardly and of God and what the Lord Jesus Christ does, and we pray to God. And so you find there is a complete difference in the thinking process between Eastern religions and Christianity. You'll find that the Bible teaches that there are clearly two sides. Some people don't understand that. And unless you understand that there is a conflict that is taking place, you will not understand what is going on in the world, and particularly concerning God. The Bible speaks that there are spirits on both sides. There are spirits that are evil. The Bible talks about them as angels. Angels that fell from heaven. Listen as the Scripture describes them. War broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought. And they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. And so the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So it says that the devil, all of his angels were cast out to this earth. And so you have spirits, evil spirits, referring to the devil and his angels that are at work in the world today. The Bible also says that there are good angels. It says this about them in Hebrews. Are they not ministering spirits sent forth to minister for those who will inherit salvation? And so you have good angels. You have bad angels. You have both. And you and I must understand that those spirits are there and that they work in the world. And how we relate to them makes a great, great difference. And you'll find that in the New Age movement, there is one particular thread that runs all the way through all the organizations of the New Age movement. I do not know of one that it doesn't exist with. They all believe. And when I talk about organizations, if you don't understand the New Age movement is made up of many, many different organizations, which they refer to as networking. Many different organizations, but the one thread that I'm going to talk about tonight, and I could talk about many different areas, but the one thread that I would like to talk about is that of the immortality of the soul. That runs through all of them. Something that you find them talking about doing called channeling. You have read anything about it? Shirley MacLaine talks a great deal about channeling. If you have read about such people as Edgar Casey or Ruth Montgomery, Bridie Murphy, Jean Dixon, all these people have dealt with what they refer to as channeling. Ruth Montgomery talks about how that when she sets down at a typewriter, that another spirit comes in and possesses her body, and the things that she writes out on the typewriter are things that this spirit that has possessed her is putting on the typewriter. Such men as Edgar Casey talked about channeling and talking with the dead. Arthur Ford. What I'm trying to say to you tonight is those who follow those such things find themselves in conflict with the Word of God. For instance, Edgar Casey was a very avid Bible student to start with. Studied God's Word. Then he got into channeling or talking to the dead. Arthur Ford was a Christian minister, but he also got into channeling or talking to the dead. It led both those men to turn away from God's Word, to reject it. And so it's very vital tonight that you and I understand clearly, I mean clearly, what the Bible has to say about communicating with the dead, about the immortality of the soul. What does the Bible say happens to a person when he dies? Do they retain their senses? Can the dead see, hear, taste, touch? Do they experience such things as joy, sorrow, pain? Just exactly what happens to an individual when he dies? That's what we need to look at tonight. Because once you have that subject clear in your head, you will be able to understand clearly what God's Word has to say for you in which way you need to go. In the Metropolitan Museum in New York City, there is a bust of a man by the name of Edgar Allan Poe, a poet. I don't know if you ever remember any of his poetry. Wrote one called The Raven. Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered weak and weary over a many a forgotten lore, while I pondered nearly napping, suddenly there came a tapping as someone gently rapping at my chamber door. You remember that? Edgar Allan Poe. On that bust, they have written these words. He was great. Ingenious, unhappy in life, wretched in death, but in fame he is immortal. Tonight, I want to talk to you about a much, much better type of immortality. Much better than Edgar Allan Poe, his fame. Because the Bible says some clear things about immortality. But has now been revealed by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. So it says that in Jesus Christ, immortality has been brought to life. Now the scripture tells us that only one person possesses immortality, that you keep this commandment without spot, blameless, until our Lord Jesus Christ appearing, which he will manifest in his own time. He who is the blessed and the only potentate, the King of the kings, the Lord of lords, listen, who alone has immortality. What did that say? Who alone has immortality. Nobody else. The Bible does not teach, friends, that you and I are immortal. The Bible teaches just the opposite. It says that we are mortal, that we are subject to death, that only God hath immortality, dwelling in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen nor can see, to whom be honor and everlasting power. So only God hath immortality. Can we as human beings, can you and I ever have immortality? What does the scripture say about that? Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. Now, God says that as the righteous are resurrected from the grave, that they're going to be changed. Listen. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal, this what? This mortal must put on immortality. Oh, yes. The Bible says that you, that I, will receive immortality, but we're going to receive it at the resurrection. Get it clear. You and I do not have immortality now. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. So you and I, the Bible says, are mortal, and we will not receive immortality until the resurrection morning. When God, when the Lord Jesus Christ calls all the righteous from the grave, then you and I will receive immortality. But not until then. In fact, the Bible says that this is our condition. This is what the Bible says that you and I are like when we die. But man dies and is laid away. Indeed, he breathes his last. And where is he? I know people that think he flies off somewhere. You know? Get this idea that he goes somewhere. I have a friend who had a little girl. The little girl was about 4 or 5 years old. They went out to the cemetery to put some flowers on their aunt's grave, their aunt's grave. They got out there and they laid the flowers on the grave. And the little girl was standing beside her mother and the wheels were turning, you know. She tugged on her mother's dress and she said, is Aunt Polly in there? Aunt Polly in there in the grave? The mother said, oh, no, no. But Aunt Polly's up in heaven. The girl said, well, why are we putting the flowers here on the grave? You know, mother not knowing what to do, you know, kind of, she said, well, Aunt Polly's body's there, but she's up in heaven. The little girl said, Aunt Polly's up in heaven running around without a body? So you get in some real difficult situations. So the prophet says, where is he? Let's see if we can establish tonight exactly what the Bible says. Where is he? For in death there is no remembrance of you in death. In the grave, who will give you thanks? Says a person dies, they don't know anything. The dead do not praise the Lord, nor any who go down into silence. It says that there is no remembrance in the grave. It says a person dies, he doesn't praise the Lord. In fact, it goes on and says this about it. For the living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing. Let me tell you something, dear friends. There very clearly is taught in God's Word that there are evil spirits. Those are fallen angels. It says that there are good angels. But this idea that's put out, that when people die, they go out into some spirit form. No, the Scripture says the dead know not anything. And they have no reward, for the memory of them is forgotten. Also their love, their hatred, their envy have now perished. Nevermore will they have a share in anything that is done under the sun. So the Bible just simply says when that person closes his eyes in death, he's not going to know anything after that until the resurrection morning. The Bible says his sons come to honor and he what? He doesn't know it. They are brought low and he does not perceive it. Person dead. He doesn't know what's going on. I find so much being taught out here today in the world about life after death. Take you down to the bookstore and probably show you a half a dozen books on the market right now. Strange thing about it is none of them agree with one another. The Bible says that when a person dies, he doesn't know anything. Sons come to honor, they know it not. The Bible refers, the Word of God refers to death as a sleep. That's the way it talks about it, as a sleep. Consider and hear me, O Lord my God. Enlighten my eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death. It says that when that person dies, he is asleep. Okay? You see, when you haven't eaten a large evening meal, and you've worked hard all day, and you're tired, and you go to sleep, and you sleep soundly, and you don't dream, how quick does morning come, folks? Just like that. So it is in death. To that person who closes his eyes in sleep, in death, it will only seem a moment, and he'll open his eyes to see Jesus Christ come. Sleep to sleep of death. Listen as it continues on. Jesus, and I, if you didn't have, folks, if you didn't have any other text in the whole Bible than the one I'm going to read to you tonight, it would make this subject perfectly clear. Jesus is speaking to his disciples, and he's talking about a very close friend of his by the name of Lazarus. Lazarus had two sisters, Mary and Martha. Jesus was very, very close to these people. These things he said, and after that he said to them, our friend Lazarus, what? Sleeps. But I go that I may wake him up. Now his disciples thought Jesus was talking about him sleeping. Now Lazarus' sisters had sent Jesus a note saying that Lazarus was sick. So the disciples knew that. They knew that he was sick. So Jesus said, Lazarus is asleep. I'm going to go wake him up. Then his disciples said, Lord, if he sleeps, he'll get well. They said, you leave him alone. They said, don't go wake him up. Let him sleep, because if he sleeps, he's going to get well. You shouldn't bother him. That's what the disciples are saying to him. However, Jesus spoke of his death. But they thought he was speaking about taking a rest in sleep. Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. You see, Jesus referred to death as a sleep. That person simply closes their eyes. By the way, Jesus left there. It took him 2 days to walk down to Bethany. And you remember, he resurrected Lazarus, called him forth from the grave. By the way, from the time Lazarus died until Jesus called him forth from the grave, he didn't know a thing. When Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come forth, it says that he came forth from the tomb. Until then, he was asleep. That's what the scripture says about him. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. So it says, those that are asleep in the dust of the earth will awake when Jesus comes. They're going to wake up. But dear friends, there's no time there. Those people aren't going to be aware of that. They simply closed their eyes, woke up to see Jesus come. You know, it's strange what we hear, what's taught on the subject. It's not logical. You know, I have to be very, very careful here. I came over, and they took me down here. And they rented a car, and they said, here you are. Man, I really have to watch it. You know, And not only do I have to watch it when I'm driving, I have to watch it when I'm walking. You know, because I'm used to crossing the street, and when I cross the street, I always look to the left. That's dangerous over here. I need to look this way, you know. Let's say I'm not watching, and I look this way, it's clear. And I step out in the street, car hits me, knocks me down, knocks me unconscious. Do I know anything? Huh? No, I'm unconscious. I don't know anything. They call the ambulance. Ambulance comes. They put me in the ambulance and they rush me to the hospital. They roll me into the emergency room. The doctor examines me and he says, this man's hurt internally. We've got to do something for him. We're going to have to operate. They call the anesthetist. The anesthetist comes and begins to give me the anesthetic. Puts me to sleep. Do I know anything? No, I'm asleep. And the doctor starts operating on me. And while he's operating on me, my heart stops beating, and now I know everything. No, folks. That isn't the way it is. It says that dead do not know anything, that they're asleep. That's why it says those that are asleep in the dust will remain so until Jesus comes, and he will call them forth. You say, well, Brother Cox, how do you put all that together? How do you make all that fit together? You see, all we have to do tonight is define our terms. What are we talking about when we talk about the body? What do we mean when we talk about the spirit? What are we talking about when we talk about the soul? What are those? Listen to what the Scripture says about it. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and he shall stand at last on the earth. Now, folks, listen carefully. Job is saying, I know that my Redeemer lives, and he shall stand at last on the earth. And after my skin is destroyed, that means in the grave, this I know, that in my flesh, I shall see God. You're not going to be some invisible spirit floating around on a cloud. He said, in my flesh, I shall see God. Now, these bodies of ours are flesh. We know that when a person dies, we know that the body begins to decompose. We know that it returns back to the earth. We've attended funeral services where we've heard the minister say, ashes to ashes and dust to dust. We understand that decomposition sets in and the body returns back to the dust. That's what the Scripture says happens. The body is simply going to return back to the dust. But it says that when Jesus comes, and he calls all the people from the grave. Job said, in my flesh, I shall see God. You and I will be real people. We'll have real bodies. God tells us that. That's the way he created us in the beginning. That's the way we will be when he comes back. In the sweat of your face, you shall eat bread, till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you shall return. So the Bible just simply says that when a person dies, his body returns back to the earth. Then the dust will return to the earth as it was. The spirit will return to God who gave it. Okay, so we know what happens to the body. We're not in doubt about that. What does it mean when it says the Spirit shall return to God who gave it? Let's see if the Bible won't help us define what it means by Spirit. For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. So the scripture just simply says if you take the spirit out of the body, what happens to the person? They're dead. So when it talks about a spirit, and it says that returns to God who gave it, then that spirit, folks, has to have something to do with your life and with mine. That's what it says. Now watch. As long as my breath is in me, the breath of God is in my nostrils. You see, when it uses the word spirit, in Greek, that's the word pneuma. That word means breath. Means the breath. It means the breath of life that God gives. Now, don't misunderstand me tonight. I'm not talking about oxygen. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the breath of life that God gives. You go into that delivery room when that baby's born. And let me tell you something. If the breath of life doesn't take place there, the doctor can pump oxygen into that baby all day long, and it'll never live. It takes the breath of life that only God can give. And it says, that goes back to God who gave it. That is what the scripture refers to as the spirit. So the body returns to the earth as it was. The breath of life goes back to God. What happens then? What happens to what we might call the soul? We're defining our terms. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground. That's the body. Breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, that's the spirit, and man became a living soul. Now, folks, that text does not say what some people read it to say. That text does not say that God here had a body, which he created from the dust of the ground, and here he had the breath of life, which is the spirit, and here he had a soul, and he put the three together. That isn't what that says. It says that God made a body from the dust of the ground. And he took the breath of life. And he put the breath of life in that body. And they became a living soul. You follow me? You tonight are souls. Because you have a body and you have the breath of life. That makes you a living soul. It takes those two things to make a soul. That's what that text says. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, listen, piercing even to the vision of the soul and the spirit and the joints and the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. So God says there is a distinction between the spirit and the soul. What is the soul? This is what the scripture says that the soul is. The soul is you. And let's see if I can illustrate it tonight. We live in a time of computers. Here we have a picture of some computers. You can have a keyboard. You can have a monitor. You can have the hard disk. You can have all the different paraphernalia that it takes to make up a computer. But dear friends, as it is right there, it won't do you any good. In order for that computer to work, it needs something. You can have a body. See, just a body. But by that alone, it won't do any good. You've got to put electricity to it. When you put electricity to that computer, it then will begin to do certain things for you, and you can enter information into that computer, and it will give you information back. It will store up information. It'll do all that for you. Okay? Now I want to ask you something. Here I've put all kinds of information in the computer. I've stored it. I've backed it up. And then let's say that I unplug the computer. I pull out the plug. Have I lost all the information? Now you're familiar with computers. Have I lost all the information? No. It's stored. Same thing. You've got a body. And God gave you the breath of life. And all the information you go through life is stored. And when you die, the breath of life goes back to God who gave it. The body decomposes. But on the resurrection morning, when the Lord Jesus Christ comes and He calls and the body forms again and the breath of life enters into that body, you're going to be you. Now just think, folks, with me for a minute. If God could just do away with all of it, then He wouldn't need you around. But dear friend, let me tell you something. You are special. You're unique. There's not another individual like you in the universe. That's the reason God's not willing to start over. You're special. And God doesn't want you to be lost. God wants you to be saved. There's not another, and there never in the entire universe and through eternity, dear friends, there will never be another individual like you. Do you understand that? What a terrible waste for you to miss eternity. Terrible. That's why on the resurrection morning, God is going to call you from the grave. And all that information, that personality, that character will be there, and you will be a real person. That's the soul. The soul is your personality, your character. It's you. You've got to have a body. You've got to have the breath of life to make you a soul. That's what the Scripture's talking about. Remember, this ruler of the synagogue, his daughter had died. And went to Jesus. Asked Him to do something. Now all wept and mourned for her. Listen, and He said, do not weep. She is not dead, but sleeping. Jesus said, no, don't weep. She's not dead. She's sleeping. Listen how these people reacted. And they laughed Him to scorn, knowing that she was dead. They said, you don't even know what you're talking about. This girl is dead. And He put them out. Put them out of the room. Took her by the hand and called, saying, little girl, arise. Took her by the hand and said, get up. Little girl, arise. And then her spirit, what? Returned. The breath of life returned. And she arose immediately, and He commanded that she be given something to eat. The breath of life entered back into her body, and she got up, folks. You see, Jesus Christ is the one that has immortality. He's the one that has the ability to call you and I from the grave. Let me tell you something, friend. You don't have that of yourself. You're mortal. You don't have immortality. Need the Lord Jesus Christ, for the Lord Himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. All those people down through the periods of time that have died in hope. They died in faith. They died believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. When the Lord comes, He's going to shout, and His words are going to roll through this earth like peals of the loudest thunder. And all those that have died are going to hear that voice, and they're going to come out of the grave. Those that are living, then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Those that are alive, they're going to see Jesus come. With those that have been resurrected, they're going to be caught up in the air to meet the Lord in the air. Oh, it says Jesus is going to come. It says He's going to shout. It tells you what He's going to shout. Your dead shall live. Together with my dead body they shall arise. And then He's going to shout out across this whole earth to all those that are dead in the grave, awake and sing, ye who dwell in the dust. For your dew is like the dew of herbs, and the earth shall cast out her dead. Just think. As Jesus shouts out to all those people, awake and sing, ye that dwell in the dust. And all those four ears are going to hear those words. They're going to come out of that grave. Not like they went into the grave. They're going to come out of that grave incorruptible. They're going to come out of that grave immortal. They're going to come out of that grave singing, and they're going to sing, oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? Dear friend, tonight, let me tell you something. If you're lost, if you live on this old earth this little period of time, and you miss eternity, how sad. How sad. You men, if all you have in this world is this short time, to love your wife, to care about your children. Few short years you have to get acquainted with your grandchildren. And you're gone. And that's all there is to you. What a pity. What a pity. You women. That's all you're going to have? Few short years on this old earth, and you're going to give it up. You're not going to know the joys that you could have with your family and your loved ones. Oh, dear friend, how sad. When the Lord Jesus Christ is offering to you life, eternal life. Oh, to think that one of these days He's coming back. Be able to look at Him face to face with Christ my Savior. Oh, how wonderful, marvelous that will be.
Face to face with Christ my Savior. Face to face to see. Jesus Christ.
white card again this evening? If you don't have one, if you just raise your hand, our ushers will give you one. We'd like everybody to have one. Three very important questions tonight, friends. If you don't have a card, just raise your hand. Our ushers will give you one. You need to listen very carefully because I want you to understand the difference between something here. A lot of people miss that. First question says, I understand that the dead will sleep until the resurrection. Tonight, if you understand, as Jesus said, that they're asleep, when he comes, he's going to call the people forth from their sleep, then put a check by number one. Put a check by number one. Second question says, I understand that the righteous will receive immortality at the, when? Resurrection. Now, I want you to get real clear. When do you receive immortality? At the resurrection. It says, then shall this mortal put on immortality. If you understand that, then put a check by number two. Third question says, I'd like to accept eternal life in Christ. Now listen carefully to me. When do you receive eternal life? You receive eternal life the moment you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. The moment that you reach out in faith and you accept Jesus Christ, you receive eternal life. As Jesus was talking to them, to Martha, he said, even though a man may die, yet he shall live again. You see, I receive eternal life in Christ Jesus right now. At the resurrection morning, I will receive immortality. If tonight you knew that if you were to die right now, you'd be lost. And tonight, you'd like to accept Jesus Christ, receive the gift of eternal life, then put a check by number three. Put your name and your address on it and fill it out. As Maddie said.
Face to face shall I be.
The resurrection, put a check by number one. If you understand that it's at the resurrection that you and I will receive immortality, put a check by number two. And if tonight you would like to accept Jesus Christ and receive the gift of eternal life, then put a check by number three. Put your name, your address on it. We're going to ask the ushers to pass those white containers to you, and if you'd just drop in your card and pencil at this time. Thank you. coming right on down to very important subjects. The subjects that we're into lay the groundwork for other subjects. So I hope you can keep your calendars clear. Like Tuesday night, a subject the day after Christ's return will lay some groundwork for the next subject. We're going to come in on Wednesday night, and Friday night we're going to finish up the first angel's message. Two very important subjects on creation's mystery, resting in Christ. And then we start into the second angel's message, folks. We're going to be dealing with such subjects as the Antichrist, Armageddon, the fall of Babylon, some very important subjects that set, and these subjects that we're into now, set the groundwork for those subjects. So make every effort you can to be here each night as we study God's Word together. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, we thank Thee so much for Jesus. Thankful for Your love towards us. Lord, we're thankful that in Christ Jesus we have life. That without Him, we don't. Bless each one here tonight, that they may simply reach out in faith and accept the gift of life eternally in Christ Jesus, and that all of us may have the privilege of being with Thee in Thy kingdom. For this we ask in Christ's name. Amen. Good night. God bless you.